The RP968 Porsche is one of the standout competitors in the Pro Class here at World Time Attack Challenge. Now, it's just gone out and run a 1 minute 19.8 lap time. This makes it the first World Time Attack car to ever go under 1 minute 20. It's also the second fastest car outright around Sydney Motorsport Park. We're here with Matt from PR Tech to find out a little bit more about what makes this car so fast. The car has been developed now for a few years. There's a lot of time, a lot of technology, and certainly a lot of money that has gone into it. There's a lot of things that I want to dig into here, but can we start, of course, with that amazing work of art, the Elmer Racing billet engine. How instrumental has that billet engine been in the performance that you're getting out of the 968 right now?
Oh, it's definitely played a big part because the engine's a lot more flexible in its power delivery. Compared to the old engine, it's a lot stronger in the top end than the old cast engine, definitely.
Now, in terms of the power that you're producing at the moment, could you have produced the power levels that the billet engine is making on the original factory engine?
Yes, it definitely could have, but boost would have come on a lot later and it wouldn't have been anywhere near as drivable.
Is this due to primarily the additional capacity?
Yeah, mostly due to that factor, yes.
And what is the capacity on the Elmer Thor engine?
It's 4 litres, yeah. The old one was 3.1.
Well, that's a big change in capacity. What sort of power levels are you running here at the moment?
We're making about 850 horsepower at the wheels on about 1.8 bar boost.
So realistically, that's not crazy power level. So particularly with the billet engine, you should be able to expect relatively good reliability as well.
Yeah, definitely. They're fairly mild boost levels for a full billet engine for sure.
And if you had the need to turn the power up further, is there more potential in the engine and turbo package right now?
There is definitely some headroom there. Not a huge amount though, because the turbo's size for maximum flexibility instead of outright power.
And what is the turbo that's running on the car?
It's a GTX42.
And with that GTX42 on a 4-litre engine, what sort of RPM are you seeing full boost? Or in other words, what sort of usable rev range has the car got?
We've got full boost about 4,200 RPM and a peak power at about 7,500 RPM.
And how far can you rev it through? Where's the rev limiter set?
About 8.3.
Okay, so particularly with that sequential transaxle in the back of the Porsche, that's going to give the driver a lot of flexibility in the power band.
Oh, absolutely. That's the whole point of that big capacity engine, is that you can pull out of a corner in a tall gear and then run that along.
Now, the car, despite the fact it clearly looks like it's got a hell of a lot of aero downforce on it, it is still rear-wheel drive, so there is some challenges there with getting the power to the ground. Now, you're running a traction control strategy through the Emtron KV8, but of course you also want to develop the power delivery so that you're not really relying on the traction control, I guess kind of keeping that traction control more as a safety backstop. So can you talk to us about the strategies you're using in terms of boost per gear or boost per throttle by throttle position?
Yeah, absolutely. The boost is definitely mapped heavily off throttle position and also gear dependent. And that's basically adjusted every session due to track conditions.
So the gear-dependent boost, I mean, that makes a lot of sense to most people. Obviously, you're not going to be able to put full power to the ground at low speed and maybe second or third gear where you don't have the benefit of that aero downforce. So as the downforce increases, the ability to put more power to the track increases. But can you talk to us a little bit more about how mapping the boost relative to the driver's foot pedal position allows the driver to modulate the torque better and get better control of the car?
Yeah, for sure. Well, basically, as he's winding on, say, half throttle through a gentle sweeping corner, you may only want, say, 70% of the power that he could modulate easily, whereas typically with a turbo car, you can make full power at nearly 80% throttle.
So in general, if you're not using that strategy, the power or torque delivery versus throttle position is very non-linear. That's basically what you're saying?
Absolutely. Also, the problem is that once they're on full boost, as you roll out of the throttle, they tend to just keep driving forward. So by pulling that boost aim back as you roll off 100%, you can reduce the power easily.
So essentially, in a way, you're kind of trying to make a turbocharged engine respond to the throttle a little bit more like a naturally aspirated engine?
Yeah, that's definitely the goal, yeah.
Now, despite the fact 850 horsepower, we're not talking massive numbers there. The car is still expected to run for a full lap or maybe even several laps. So that's a lot of stress on the engine over a 1 minute 20 lap. Are there any special strategies you're using in the Emtron KV8 in order to provide engine protection if something goes wrong, maybe the engine coolant temperature or intake air temperature become too high?
The main safety that's running is the exhaust gas temperature. Once it reaches a ceiling, I start pouring the fuel in to cool it off.
So that's just a protection around that temperature, making sure that the engine is cooled down by that additional fuel if it's required?
Yeah, that's the point of it, yes.
Okay, so when the car comes back in from a session out on the track, you're going to be looking at the data, download that data and inspecting it. So can you tell us about your priorities in that data logging? What are you looking for first and foremost?
The first thing I'm going to check is that the boost is running as per the target. Second of all, I'm going to watch the coolant pressure, make sure we're not having any internal leakage around the head gasket, and knock. Closely watching the knock traces as well, and probably mixture with EGTs are high as well. Finally, it's probably oil pressure. Definitely check that first.
So I think that's one thing that a lot of people kind of tend to overlook is that it doesn't really matter how much power you're producing or how fast the car is. In order to get those lap times, the first priority is making sure the engine health is okay and the engine is going to be able to continue running. So in terms of the knock system, are you actually running knock control on the engine or are you just logging the data from the knock sensors?
On this one, I'm only logging the data. I haven't got active control turned on it.
And on E85, are you expecting that knock is an issue or is it fairly immune to knock?
No, you can definitely still create knock on E85, for sure.
Also in terms of the coolant pressure, so this is something we see a lot of high boost drag engines using, a little bit less common on a circuit application. So can you just give us a little bit more detail around how that works? You mentioned around the head gasket sealing, so what will that coolant pressure sensor trace show you in your data logging?
It will typically show if you're starting to lift the cylinder head, and also if you see it combined with knock, you can also see a trace that will sort of confirm that you are starting to lift that cylinder head, and you'll see little rises in that coolant pressure with the knock trace at the same time.
So essentially there, particularly with lifting the head, you're allowing combustion pressure to enter the cooling system, hence the pressure trace will increase?
That's correct.
So finally, once you've gone through and you know that the engine is healthy, you've got a range of other sensors on the car. What are you looking for in order to help improve the driver's lap times and also maybe improve the chassis performance?
The main thing I'm looking for is how closely my slip levels are following my aim slip in the traction control. If the traction control is working too heavily in the lower gears, I'm better off pulling some power back and then trying to apply it at different parts of the track if I can.
So that was sort of coming back to what we were talking about earlier, where you're trying to rely on that traction control more as a safety backstop rather than heavily using the traction control at every part of the track?
Yeah, absolutely. Yep.
Look, Chris, it's been great to get some insight into the RP968. You've still got one more session to go, although the weather is looking a little bit marginal. Best of luck to improve that lap time. It's already a scorching lap time, so congratulations on that, and thanks for chatting.
Okay, no worries, thanks.
like that video, make sure you give it a thumbs up. And if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you're subscribed. We release a new video every week. And if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description to claim your free spot to our next live lesson.